Thank you so much, Harry, for the introduction. Thank you, Lewis, for the good introduction. So let's start the second part of this presentation. So we will talk about the fission reaction, the reactor operations, and so the fuel that we can use in the reactor, and then the spallation technique to make neutrons. Okay, so let's go and let's talk about the fuel that we can use in the nuclear reactor. So we're talking about the uranium isotopes. Sorry. Okay, so actually we have three kind of isotopes for the uranium that we can use in the nuclear reactor. So we have the uranium-235, 233, and 238. All the isotopes that is possible to use in the nuclear reactor can be divided in two different groups. So we have the fissile isotopes and fissionable isotopes. What is the difference? The difference is that the first one requires thermal neutron for the fission reaction. The second one, the fissionable, required fast neutron for the fission. There are there are also other isotopes that can be used in a nuclear reactor, for example, thorium and plutonium. And those three are fissionable, so require fast neutron. And these two are fissile isotopes. In the fissionable groups, between the fissionable isotopes, we can find also some isotopes that are called fertile isotopes, that are, for example, those two. Fertile means that if those isotopes acquire one neutron, can become, for example, fissile. So from fissionable to fissile isotopes. For example, the thorium-232 plus one neutron is the uranium-233. Uranium-238 plus one neutron is plutonium-239. So from fissionable to fissile material. Okay, so now before going to the fission reaction, let's talking about very briefly what the cross section is. So the cross section, the microscopic cross section, is the area that a particle during the collision, in a target nuclei, can see off the target nuclei. For example, in this image here, we have the neutron that is in collision with the target nuclei, for example, the uranium-235. Then this particle can see an area of the target nuclei, and this area is the cross-section that the neutron can see of the target nuclei. This area is around 10⁻²⁴ centimeters squared, that is 1 bar, essentially. Okay, so is the area viewed better? Okay, so to understand even better what a cross-section is, let's take this example over here. So we have a source of neutron, a source of beads, for example, and then here we have the target material. Target material constitutes, in this case, from, for example, free walls. So the beads coming out from the source are in interaction with this target material. Some of them are in collision, and other beads can pass through the material. So with this equation here, we can calculate the probability of neutron, in this case of beads, that is in interaction with the target. So for example, we have the number of atoms, that in this case is the number of walls in the target material. Then we have the cross section, that in this case is the area of the wall that the particle can see. And this one, so over the area of the section of the beam that is coming out from the source. Okay, so this is the probability. Then let's move to the rate of the nuclear neutron interaction. So how many interactions per second? That is equal to the cross section, so the area, for example, the wall, times the flux, so how many beads are coming out from the source in a unit area, times the number of atoms, number of walls, for example, in our case. Okay, so the microscopic cross-section, the cross-section in general, is not actually a geometrical parameter. We have, for example, in this case, the cross section over the energy of, for example, a neutron. So the neutron, essentially the cross section is how large a colliding neutron sees the nuclei target. And this how large is depending on the energy of the neutron, so of the speed of the neutron. Okay, so, and I mean, the cross section we can see in this graph that is varying over the energy of the neutron. So the we have different kind of cross section. So we have, for example, the absorbance cross section, the scattering cross section, and also, for example, the fission cross section, that is a special case of absorbance. Okay, so let's go on and let's talk about, okay, yeah, this is an example of the cross section. Okay, so for example, this area here are the thermal energy of the neutrons. This area over here are the energy of the fast neutrons. And this part here is the resonance zone. It's called resonance zone. Okay, so now let's talk about the fission reaction. Okay, so in principle, we have a neutron in collision with a target nuclei, that in this case, for example, is the uranium-235. So now we have the uranium-236, that is an unstable nucleus because it is in the excited state. Means that this nucleus can do the fission reaction. So from the fission reaction, we have two fragments that are coming out from the reaction, a lot of energy, gamma beta radiation, and neutrons. This is a typical spectra of neutrons that are coming out from the fission reaction of the uranium-235. And the average energy of the neutrons is around 1 to 2 mega electron volt, more or less. In this graph here is represented the atomic weight of the two fragments that are coming out from the reaction. So for example, the first one is 95 Dalton, more or less, the other one 135. Okay, so about the energy, we have from the fission reaction 192 mega electron volt of energy. So, but where does all this energy come from? So let's talking about the binding energy graph. So we have the binding energy graph over here. So we have that the uranium, for example, 235, is more or less in that area here. Then the fragments are more or less in that area here. Means that the binding energy for a nucleon in the uranium is less than the binding energy for nucleon in the fragments. Means that the fragments are more stable than the uranium. Means that the reaction is an isergonic reaction, because from the unstable nucleus, we get very stable fragments. So the additional binding energy is that energy that is releasing after the reaction. So it means that this step of binding energy here times the nucleon that are in interaction in this reaction is 192 mega electron volts. Okay, so now let's go on. And so let's talk about the energy balance. For the fission reaction, we need around 6 to 9 mega electron volt of energy. Okay, so for example, if we are able to take one neutron and put it directly in the nucleus of the, for example, uranium-235, this amount of binding energy in the nucleus is enough for the fission reaction. So, because one neutron more in the uranium nucleus is around 7 mega electron volt, that is inside this range here. So, is enough the amount of binding energy that is adding a neutron in the nucleus. Means that for the fission reaction, we need the neutrons with very low kinetic energy, that are, for example, the thermal neutrons. For that reason, we need the thermal neutrons to make fission reaction for the uranium-235. So all the 192 mega electron volt of energy are coming out in the form of kinetic energy of the fermions, fast neutron, delayed neutrons, and gamma and beta radiation. Okay, so now the neutrons that are coming out from the reaction are around, like told before, around 1 to 2 mega electron volts. And so if we want to use that neutrons to make other fission reaction, we have to cool down that neutrons. We have to cool down that neutrons from mega electron volts to electron volts, like, for example, 0.025 electron volts. Okay, so essentially we have to moderate the neutrons to get it ready to use for other fission reaction. Okay, so let's talk about now about the alpha parameter. Alpha parameter is the ratio between the cross section, the capsule cross section, and the fission cross section. So, for example, in this graph here, we have both cross section of the uranium 235. Okay, so we have this zone here that is the resonance zone, and this part here is the thermal neutron zone, and this part is the intermediate and fast neutron zone. So from in a nuclear reactor, we want fission, right? Because we want neutrons. So we have to optimize this alpha parameter, because we don't want that the neutron are captured by the uranium with the gamma or beta radiation decay then, because the neutrons are in that case lost. So we want to maximize the alpha parameter in order to have more fission as possible, essentially. So for example, in this area here, we have a cross section for both more or less around 1 or 10 minus 1. That is a very low cross section, means that the probability to have both the reaction is very low. Okay, so means that we have to use this part here, so the thermal neutron part, where the cross section is high enough to have enough probability to have both the reactions. In this case here, from the graph over there, we can see that the alpha parameter in that region is around 10%. Means that 10% of the neutrons that are in collision with uranium are captured, so are lost. But it's okay. Okay, so now, how many neutrons for fission are coming out from the reaction? So from this graph here, we have the number of neutrons coming out from the reaction over the energy of the neutrons. But we told before that this is the typical spectra of the fission reaction from the uranium 235, right? And we have an average of around 1 mega electron volt. Means that in this graph, we are around here. So for fission, we have averaged around 2.5 neutrons. But all the neutrons are the same from the fission reaction? The answer is no. No, because we have the prompt neutrons and the delayed neutrons. The first one are, the energy is around 1 to 2 mega electron volts, and are coming out from the reaction immediately. Then we have the delayed neutron that are around 1% of the total energy of the reaction. The energy is much less than the prompt neutrons, and are from the decay of the fragments, and can be divided in different 6 groups. For example, if one of the 2 fragments is a bromine, after 55 seconds from the fission reaction, the bromine emit 1 neutron. So for example, for 22 seconds, iodine, etc. Okay, so now let's talking about the reactor operations. So 1 neutron from the fission reaction can be absorbed by, for example, the fuel, transforming the fertile isotopes in fission isotopes, okay? Or can be absorbed also by the reactor material. In this case, the neutrons are completely lost, right? Then we have that the neutrons that are going out from the nuclear reactor And some of them, in our case, are going to the instrument also. And the other case is that the neutrons can go back to the fuel to make other fission reactions. Okay, so now it's important to understand that essentially we want a fission chain reaction, right? So we want that the neutrons from the fission reaction can do other fission reactions. And we want to control this reaction, so we want to control that. We want the steady state reaction, right? We want to we want the neutrons that are constant over the time. So we have to introduce the multiplication factor. The multiplication factor is the ratio between the neutrons in one generation and neutron in the precedent generation. So if the k is equal to one, means that the neutron after and before is the same, right? So we have the critical condition of the nuclear reactor. If the k is less or more than one, we have the subcritical or supercritical condition. Okay, so now how we can control the k of the nuclear reactor using the rules. Okay, we can talk about rules later. Okay, so now the multiplication factor is essentially also the rate of the neutron production over the rate of the neutron loss in a reactor. The lifetime is the total number of neutrons in that time over the losses of neutrons. Then we can write the growth of the neutrons like the production rate minus the loss rate. Then we can write this equation over here that we can solve assuming that K and L are constant over the time. And so we have this equation here. But those equations actually are super interesting because the same kind of equation can be used also in biology. Can be used, for example, to describe isolated population of bacteria, for example. In fact, we have the same K factor in biology. We have the lifetime, that is the time generation of the bacteria. So how much time from one fission to another. Then we have this, that is the growing of bacteria and the exponential curve growth. But in our case, in the neutron case, we have per fission for the uranium superfluid, 2.5 neutrons per fission. But about the bacteria is a binary fission, right? So from one bacteria to bacteria. Okay, so now let's plot this equation here, and we have this. So we can see that we have the critical condition where the number of neutrons before and after is the same. And then we have supercritical and subcritical. And for example, in biology, we can play with the amount of nutrients in the medium to make k equal to one, for example, to have the same number of bacteria over the time. And in a nuclear reactor, we can play again with the rods. Okay, so now this is the IRR reactor. So it's the scheme over there. We have the reflector over there. Then we have the fuel where the uranium is. Then we have the central channel. Okay, so it is a good representation. So we have the central channel here, the fuel over there, and then we have the reflector where the EV water is. Actually, the EV water is also in the central channel. We have different kind of moderation to have a different range of wavelength of the neutrons. So we have the cold, the thermal, and hot with different kind of moderation material. Okay, so this is another representation. So the control rules, the one that we can use to control the K value, are inside, so in the central channel over here. And we have also the security rules that are five that are over there. Okay, so now let's talk about rules. Okay, the rules are objects that can absorb neutrons, right? Are movable objects, so we can move up and down to play like a valve, right? So we can adjust the number of neutrons that are going back to the fuel to make other fission reactions. The material for the control rods is nickel, And for the safety rolls is AIC material. So both materials have a microsection for the thermal neutrons, so it can absorb a lot of thermal neutrons. The material must be resistant to corrosion, high temperatures, and irradiation, because there is a lot of irradiation from the core. And the ILL, for example, has different shape, material rods. Okay, so now another important thing to discuss is the poisons. We have actually two types of poisons. The first one is the burnable poison. That is a material that we can put near to the fuel to absorb a neutron. This is important for the early stage of the fuel. So when the fuel is new and is decreasing, this burnable poison is decreasing over the core life, sorry. Which is good because we don't need we need the burnable poison only in the first stages. Then the second poison is the poison from the fission reaction. So this kind of poison is increasing over the core life, and which is not good because this poison here can absorb again neutrons. The most important, the most important nuclei is the xenon. So if we have a lot of xenon over the time, I mean, if we have a lot of poison over the time in the nuclear reactor, this poison can absorb a lot of neutrons. But yeah, all this stuff can be compensated by ROTS. Okay, so summary, we have the fission reaction. So the neutrons must be moderated. We have then leakage, neutrons to the instruments. And we have here the neutrons that can go back to the fuel to make other fission reactions. And here, this control valve is essentially the ROTS. Okay, so now let's talk about the kind of material that we can use in a nuclear reactor. We have the natural uranium, where the fissile isotopes are more or less around 0.7%. But actually, with a very good moderation material, this natural isotope, the natural uranium, can self-sustain a fission reaction. Then we have the low enriched uranium, where the fissile material is around 4%, more or less. And this material here is the one that they use in a nuclear plant to make electricity. And this and the high enriched uranium, the one that ILL is using now, has an amount of fissile material around 93%, so a lot of fissile material. Okay, so now let's talk about another technique that is possible to use to make neutrons. So let's talk about spallation. Spallation, I mean, spall means flakes of material that are broken off a large solid body. Actually, spallation is a natural process, for example, within cosmic rays and nuclei in the atmosphere. So, for example, seems that these three atoms over there are from spallation reaction from these other three atoms over there. So, I mean, it's a natural process. If we want to use spallation to make neutrons, we have to use very high energetic particles. And those particles are from, for example, accelerators. So we have to use accelerators to make very high energetic particles. So we have different kinds of accelerators. For example, we have the linear accelerator that is constituted by pipes that are connected to an alternative current source. So the particles are linear accelerated over the accelerator. Then we have the cyclotron, where essentially the particles are accelerated like in a ring and is using the Lorentz force. Okay, so we have an input of the square wave electric field. Then we have the synchrotron that actually, for example, in ISIS is used like a storage ring. And from the synchrotron, usually the ions are coming out like in bunch of ions, essentially. So usually from the synchrotron, we have a pulsated source of ion. For that reason, usually the spallation source of neutrons are pulsated. Okay, so now we have a very high energetic particle from the synchrotron, for example. Okay, so we have the linear accelerator here, then we have the synchrotron, and from the synchrotron we can get very high energetic particles. So those particles are in collision now with the target material, that usually is a metal. And so in this case, the particle is in collision with the target nuclei. So the first step is the internuclear cascade, where only few particles, but very energetic, are coming out from this reaction. The second step is the evaporation, the nuclei evaporation, where the excited state nucleus can evaporate in emitting a lot of neutrons, protons, a lot of gamma radiation, beta radiation. So low energy particles, but a lot of particles. In fact, for example, from one ion, we can get around 20 to 40 neutrons more or less. So for example, in ISIS, we have a frequency of pulses around 50 Hz. So one pulse every 20 milliseconds. The particles are 1 GeV of energy, and the total energy from the spallation is around 45 MeV in 20 neutrons. Means that from 1 GeV to 45 MeV, we have an endergonic process. So means we have to give a lot of energy to have low energy particles, more or less. So from this process, we can get around 6 times more neutrons per reaction compared to the fission reaction. Okay, so now this is a comparison between the pulses and, for example, IEL is here. So we have a continuous source of neutrons. And this is, for example, a pulse of a neutron in ESS. So we have a pulse of around 3 milliseconds, 50 Hz, so 3 milliseconds of pulse in 20 milliseconds, every 10 milliseconds. Okay, so let's talking about the target that is possible to use in a spallation source. So we have the solid target, so a solid material, for example, tungsten, that is used in ISIS to get neutrons. Then it's possible to use the liquid target. For example, in SNS, they are using liquid mercury in this kind of chamber. Then we have the rotating target, for example, in ESS. I think that the material is tungsten as well, I don't remember well, but is in rotation. Okay, so yeah, this is more or less a panoramic of all the reactor spallation sources. Some of them are closed, but ILL is over here. The fission, and a lot of spallation sources are pulsated sources. Okay, so this is a comparison between the fission and spallation. So fission is ergonic, spallation endergonic process. So from the fission, we have 192 MeV per reaction, and we have 2.5 neutrons averaged. Then from the spallation, we have 45 MeV of energy, of total energy, and 20-30 neutrons per ion. And we can get 6 more neutrons per reaction. Okay, so thanks a lot. And yeah, this is a simulation of neutrons that are like fish in the lake that are moving around the fuel from Davide Portinari. Thanks a lot.